chairing next session. It's going to be 10-minute presentations, so breakneck speed. And so I'll hand you over to your Francesco, aren't you?
Yep.
Also absent friends Claudio and Raffaella. Creative thinking, a brain computer in space of art. And save your questions for the end of the panel session.
Hello everyone, I'm Francesco Suave, I'm here to present a short paper, Creative Thinking, a Brain-Computer Interface of Art. So the outline of the paper are to explore why cognitive sciences study creativity, what's a theoretical point of view about creativity, and then a scientific investigation. Then I will show an experimental example of brain-computer interfaces applied to creative context, and then some consideration. So cognitive sciences study artificial and natural intelligence, and of course one of the most investigated fields is art as creativity, as expression of creativity. Some of the questions that researchers are trying to answer are is creativity innate, or if it can be acquired, if we can somehow stimulate it, if there is any specific area of the brain where creativity resides, and also if it's something specific about human intelligence, or if it's something that also about artificial systems. So the theoretical point of view about creativity, so some definitions of creativity. Creativity can be defined as a complex cognitive process, and so the result from the balance between conscious and unconscious processes, also as a borderline state of mind. For instance, when a new idea arises to the consciousness, a new balance is achieved, and then there's a creative off state. Also, as a basic cognitive process that gives a whole experience of the world, creativity comes from how we experience everything surrounding us. Another interesting point of view by Shanzhou is that we should always also consider perception as a creative process. When we look at an artwork, for instance, in our brain, there's a sort of recreation process that takes place. So trying to find meaning or attributing emotions or mental states to the object we are looking at. How can cognitive sciences study creativity and investigating different aspects of the brain? So different brain functions related to memory, language, attention, neuromotor abilities, but also by evaluating some external stimulus that can be given to the brain. Some other interesting definitions by Kessler: creativity is a bisection mechanism. So creativity is hereby intended as means to join unrelated, sometimes or often conflicting information in a new way. Semir Zeki, which is a neuroaesthetic, compared the artist to the neuroscientist, saying that they're both exploring the ability of a brain, but using different tools. We can state that every creative art starts generally with problem solving, by thinking out of the box. So finding some creative answer to simple problems, daily problems. Problem solving and creativity are in fact correlated cognitive processes that can be analyzed by analyzing the brain, by analyzing the electrical signals in our brain. I will now introduce an interactive installation which I realized, which is called Mind the Chair. The aims of the installation is to show how creativity can be related to brain activation by creating a performance, but also to give awareness to people, to the visitor trying the installation, about how our brain works, what specific terminology like concentration or creativity mean. So, for instance, how much brain energy is required to perform a specific task. So the interactive installation is focused on giving a real-time response of the brain activity. So through some audio manipulation and some LED lights that changes depending on the level of brain waves. While using the installation, a person is actually able to understand what words like concentration mean, how to control his own brain, and of course the installation will react to this. So he will be able to control the whole installation through his brain. So basically the concept of the chair is the chair of the thinker. So thoughts that starts in the brain flows through the body, through the chair, and then in the space as light, as you can see in the picture. An important note is that during this kind of performance, I don't usually give to the visitor any physical object to focus on. This is because otherwise they would be concentrating on the object, therefore they would not be able to listen to their brain, actually. The word focus and concentration are words that I usually use to describe how the installation works and how to make it work, but it's because we are all pretty comfortable with these two words. What in fact is happening in the background is that I'm measuring the brain activity level. Some considerations about the installation. So there are different factors involved in the ability to control the brain. The experience of an individual, which is different for different people. If you ask a mathematician to perform some simple equation, this won't probably require much brain activity for himself because he's pretty comfortable with that task. The psychophysical status of the person, using a BCI, a brain computer interface tool in the morning after a good sleep or in the night when you're really tired makes a huge difference. It can be much more easier or difficult. Another interesting fact that I realized is that when the brain activity is peaking, actually, it becomes more difficult to slow it down than actually increase it. It's like if it was a car running on a highway, it takes much more effort to slow down. So, some conclusions. Neurocognitive sciences study creativity and artistic inspiration to discover and analyze cognitive processes. Cognitive technologies can be used as new artistic way of expression and allows researchers and artists to both understand how the brain can understand art or potentially create something. However, the use of brain-computer interfaces tool is not only limited to the creativity studies. For instance, they can be useful in pedagogical programs, trying to improve cognitive skills, trying to improve focusing attention on specific subjects. Also on development of multitasking abilities. And more than that, brain-computer interfaces can be enjoyed by everyone. Everyone can use it without any sort of prerequisites. Usually people trying installation tell me, oh no, I'm not gonna make it. No, I mean, your brain is working, right? So there's not really anything difficult or mysterious behind that. So I will now show a quick example, a quick video of the installation, just to show you how it works. So you can see the light is increasing and the sound also is becoming faster depending on. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, we'll save the questions to the end. So, we shall.
Can't take the pen.
Yeah, take that. Yeah, excellent. Thank you. So.
Great.
Yeah. So, Mike.
Right.
10 minutes.
Okay. Hello, everybody. I'm Mike Lowe from Plymouth University. I'm going to talk to you today about a piece called Pod, which is an installation piece, a tactile sound installation piece. I've got too much material, so I'm going to zip through the first part and concentrate on multi-sensory artworks, which is really the idea behind this talk. So, what is Pod? It started as an installation at Shunt in London, under London Bridge. It was half a dozen big climbing balloons, which are terrifying because they're just like normal balloons. If you hit them with a pin, they explode. And so that was our first try at this piece. And each one of these had some speakers inside, which you can see us making here. We had two speakers inside a cardboard tube playing very similar frequencies. So you've got the kind of beat frequency thing. And those vibrations would go through the skin of the balloons, basically, and allow people to sort of feel the sound. The initial rationale for the piece was exactly that, just to allow people to feel the sound, to give some kind of embodiment for sound. But what's become apparent as we've developed the piece since 2009 is that there's this idea of corporeal listening, this idea of listening through your stomach and through your chest and through your, you know, maybe your head, as well as through your ears. And also some interesting things that have come out in terms of multi-sensory work, so matching sounds and shapes and colours. It's also become a kind of meditative experience. So things like Bernard Lightner's sound chair and Kath Matthews' sonic bed also have this idea of feeling sound, but being immersed in sound and a kind of meditative experience. So we remade the piece in 2013. We made it like this. So this is now PVC inflatables, and they're much safer and much more robust. We had to make it outside, so what we did was we put batteries and speakers and MP3 players inside it. What we did find was that you can still roll them over, even with a 20 kilo car battery inside, so we have to tie them down in future. What we do essentially is we've then actually consequently developed it so that we transmit sounds into the pods over a guitar wireless system, which allows us to sort of control it from a PD patch external to the pods. And it gives us more control. And we've started playing around with the sound, so rather than just being a low drone or something, we've added some slightly higher notes, so then you get interesting effects like, obviously you get this beat frequencies happening, but you also get psychoacoustic effects like notes appearing to slide from one note to another, from one pitch to another. And that, to me, is interesting because I know it doesn't do that because I wrote the patch and it doesn't do that, but that's what it sounds like it does. We encourage people to interact with the pods. So the whole idea behind this is you're supposed to hug these things, basically. It's a huggy piece. And that's what's important for us in that respect, is that the interface is approachable and inviting in a way. So what we kind of want to do is to try and create a visitor experience which is a, Michel Chion talks about this idea of synchresis, like in the film that he talks about, it's the sound and an action on the film merging together to make one sensory event, one new sensory event. And in a way, that's what we're trying to do with this. We're trying to merge touch and sound and sight together to make a new sensory event for the people that come and experience the piece. And we also, there's this nice quote from Shklovsky, an aesthetic end in itself. Our perception is an aesthetic end in itself and must be prolonged. And in a way, this kind of experiential piece is, that's what it's about. It's about just people going there and having a new experience for as long as they like. Which gives me the opportunity to show you this, one of the seven wonders of the internet, Anais Nin's quote about art renewing our perception. So I'm going to show you a quick video of this, and here we go. So what I've done, this is a film from the Whitley Arts Festival a few years ago. I've actually overdubbed the latest sound of the pots, just to give you an idea of kind of what they sound like nowadays. Because I don't have a more recent video than this, unfortunately. So hopefully you've roughly got an idea of what it is, what the piece is. What we'll talk a bit about now is this idea of cross-sensory or multi-sensory correspondences, which is not synesthesia. It's not, synesthesia being a recognised medical condition in which one sense input triggers reactions in another sense. But what I want to talk about is this idea that a large amount of people will have the concept that certain sounds and colours go together, or shapes and sounds go together, etc., etc. And I know this is contentious, I know it's subjective, but there is research that backs up the idea that that these effects happen across the majority of people. Charles Spence, who works in Oxford, has built his whole career of looking at these kind of effects and things like what music you listen to while you eat some food, your taste, things like that. And so he's talking about people matching high-pitched sounds with small bright objects high up in space. And of course there's all the Kandinsky quotes about, you know, certain instruments being certain colours and things like that as well. And what we found was that long drone sounds matched the shape and the colour of the pods much better than sort of short narrative sharp sounds, which just didn't seem to match the shape at all. So we've done a little bit of, you know, empirical work on this. We also discovered that there's a kind of optimum volume. So if you think about it, the volume of an object is its size in space, and the volume of a sound is its size in space. It's how far the sound spreads. And there's a lovely quote here from Rolf Julius, where he's talking about making a piece where he's got a 1 meter squared glass plate, and he's trying to make sounds to fit that glass plate. And so basically then he sort of thought that his sounds would only fit a 0.8 meter squared plate of glass, so he had to buy a new plate of glass, which is fantastic, this kind of idea that this tiny fraction off the edge of the plate is enough to sort of change the piece. This experiment may be familiar to some of you. This is the Bubikiki experiment by Ramachandran and Hubbard. This is looking into shape as a basis for language, essentially. So, they asked people which of these shapes is Buber and which of these shapes is Kiki, across multiple cultures, actually. And I think it's about 95% shows this one is Buber and this one is Kiki. And this work builds on Wolfgang Kohler, actually made this experiment in the 30s with different names for the shapes, but the same thing. But Ramakanthan and the Hubbard kind of taken it on and made it cross-culture and so on. So it's kind of interesting to me because I'm interested in things like, well, what do we mean by a round sound, a thin sound, a hollow sound? You know, why do we use all these physical attributes to describe sounds? And so this sort of like speaks to that for me. Okay, so when you've got a piece that exists in two media, what's interesting is to imagine that work. Imagine only one medium at a time. So for this example, if you just had the object without any sound, or if you just had the sound without an object, and what do you lose? And that thing that you lose is what Chion again calls added value. It's the thing that's created. It's the greater than sum of the parts kind of idea. And for me, this is what is interesting about multisensory works. You also need to convince people that the two media are part of the same piece. And in this case, this is done by proximity. The speakers are actually inside the inflatables, and by trying to match the sounds of the objects. There are other ways to do it. If you're interested, talk to me later. And there's a bit more about it in the paper as well. So in terms of an interface, which is obviously why we're here, Pod doesn't have your normal sort of push button response to the interface. It's not a control interface. But that was quite deliberate. So we didn't want to get people involved in the kind of push button interaction response feedback loop thing. We wanted them to concentrate on the sound and the experience. But what it does have is this kind of sense of an ergonomic object which invites you to interact with it. And the perception of the sounds does actually change depending on your movements, not because it's responding, because the pod is responding, but just because you change your position of your, you know, listening position. If you put your ear against the skin of the pod, the sound changes and so on. So, and it kind of exists at the boundary between touch and hearing, which is somewhere I think is an interesting place to be. And probably the last point I want to make is just this idea that we have these interfaces that are very generic, you know, are called nano control or something, where you can map any of these controls to any parameters on our instruments and things like that. And I just wanted to throw the question out, what would happen if the interface that was designed so the look or maybe the feel of it also resembled the sounds it was controlling? Of course this cuts down maybe the amount of sounds you can control, but I just thought maybe that's an interesting question to kick around. So we move away from the generic and more towards a specific combined interface. Right, it's been at various exhibitions. We're currently making an 8-pod version. Got some money from the Arts Council. Good old Arts Council. We're also putting them in the Science Museum London in October. They wanted two for sort of educational purposes to show people that sound is vibration. So there are two going in there in the new gallery. These are people that have helped with it, and these are references. Thank you very much.
So, together with my colleague Daniel Bizik from Zurich, we've been working a lot on performing with algorithms, and this year's paper we handed in was really asking the question, what is the relationship between the human performer and the algorithm? And actually, the title, in a way, summarizes our whole paper. So I could stop right now if that was necessary. But more to the point, I think the interface is not the interface in terms of what it does. And we've seen this morning in the Chalaparta paper, where the really interesting statement was that the Chalaparta is not the object, but is actually the concept behind it. In the case of the instrument, it was the rhythm. And in our cases, we've been thinking about where is the relational layer between the performer and algorithmic system. So I'm going to show two videos, because I think that complements the paper in a way. If you're inclined to read the paper, you might have something to refer to. And those are, one is a piece for live electronics and trombone, which is this one, and the other one is for interactive dance. And they both tackle the question of where the interface is, or what the relationship between the algorithm and the human person, in two different ways. So can I lower the lights, please? Yes. That's example number one. So that was the second example, and there's many more details in the paper about these pieces. I just want to briefly show you the makeup of these pieces, because I think from the videos you might have had an impression of what it sounds and looks like, but not how it functions. So the first piece, the trombone player interacts with a machine learning system that observes his movements and produces responses that were recorded from its proper sound. So you have these different loops going on. One other aspect is that the sound is played back on the speaker on stage, so the speaker itself becomes a second figure on stage. It also has an acoustic property of being the feedback generator, so there's also an acoustic feedback next to the data feedback and the conceptual feedback. And lastly, the trombone player is playing a kind of a score with a repertoire of sound, but with an improvised gesturality, and has some tasks that are purely gesture or movement-based, which is unusual for a musician to work on, which in this sense is really essential to cross the different layers of presence. The second piece, and the reason I'm showing two pieces is I want to juxtapose them. The second piece, a dance piece, we've seen the dancer receives a kind of an avatar, but it's actually an algorithmic system that has its own morphology that is related to the dancer's morphology. So the way we can observe this is that by this extended skeleton. So there's a simulation model running underneath the interaction, where the figure that you saw react with the dancer is actually its own agent, using artificial intelligence algorithms to determine the reaction. and the model itself was grown with an evolutionary algorithm within rehearsal processes. So I think the gist of our paper is that the interfacing doesn't just happen on the physical level or on the technical level, but it actually also happens on a conceptual level. So we have the two pieces. So the middle one is the dance piece. I'll skip the technical part, but what's more interesting is like the semantic coupling, where in the dance piece, the behavioral coupling happens through the recognition of the morphology of the dancer and influences the morphology of the virtual agent, let's say. And in the music piece, in a similar way, the musician's gesturality is used to manipulate or influence the machine learning system's behaviors in terms of recording and playing back and fragmenting sound elements. So that's the kind of the meaning level. Then there's this inheritance level, which in the dance piece is, once you know the system, is quite obvious, is that there is actually a mirroring between the two body shapes in a way. And in the sound piece, the inheritance is that the sounds of the algorithmic system are actually directly deduced from the musician's sounds. And then lastly, and that I think is also crucial, is that it's an adaptive system, meaning that there is not just a design decision how to relay things, but the reactions and the behaviors of the algorithms are actually derived from the performer himself or herself, and in a way reflects the individuality of the performer. So it's not a general system anymore, it's a very specific system. And what is also interesting is that adaptation doesn't occur necessarily at the same time than the performance. So I have four main points to take away. Is where is the interfacing happening? So of course in the NIME, or in this case live interface community, we're preoccupied with the actual objects. And of course mapping has also been a big topic. But I think what is interesting here, an important point, is that we should also think about how, let's say, the affordances of the system are related to the capabilities of the performer and vice versa. So this interfacing happens on several layers, on the physical, on the technical, but also on the conceptual level. Who interfaces with whom also points to the fact that we have multiple agencies occurring. And what we haven't seen, but is usually implicitly carried along, is that there's usually a creator behind these pieces, choreographer, composer, might be the same person, but those two roles don't necessarily occur at the same time. And that's actually the third point. The interfacing happens live in performance, that's the moment it's manifested, but usually it's a process of development, so it happens in several phases. And these phases are actually, in terms of conceptual development, crucial to understand. And I think anybody who's been working either as a technologist or as a composer knows that these are really, it's crucial not to jump any of these stages in order to make a complete piece. And lastly, I think, and I mean that's for you to judge from the videos, but of course the pieces as performances have a different impact, is how readable is it? There's this old adage saying that if it looks random and sounds random, you might as well use random. And so I hope that you've seen in these pieces that there is an intrinsic relationship that charges up the pieces in a specific way. So that's what I have to say. Thanks.
And no sound. Okay?
Yeah, no sound.
Hi everyone, my name is Alexandre Clément. I'm here to present the ABEL system. The ABEL system is a system which aims to bring the audience into the performance. So as Bert Bonger says in his 2000 book, we can invite a situation that enables the performer and the audience to meet, each influencing each other. So this is the main goal of this system. Some of you might be thinking that participative audiences are hardly a new concept, and actually they're right. John Cage, for example, has played with that notion for over 40 years. Others might be thinking that even using mobile phones towards that aim isn't new as well. You're also right. Golden Levin, 15 years ago, did that on his dial tone pieces. So I'm hoping by the end of this 10 minutes I'll have showed you why the ABEL system has a uniqueness of its own. So I won't go really deep into technicalities because you can read the paper, so I won't bore you with that, but I'll give you a macro view of how the system works. So the main pieces of the ABEL system are a suite of pure data external objects which allow the content creators to make use of all the data communication and smartphone functions on which the system depends. Then you have a network layer or a data communication layer which allows the main piece to communicate with all the audience's devices. And finally you have a mobile app which is what gets distributed to all the audience so they can join into the performance. So we thought of the application as a self-sufficient instrument. So we wanted it to be something that can be operated by itself, and the whole system is thought out to be something self-sufficient as well. So any content creator, just using the ABEL system, should be able to develop performances which allow the audience to participate. So it's the whole system is based on pure data vanilla, and we bypass any format conversions by using the LeapPD wrapper, which allows to embed the pure data audio engine into a variety of formats. So developing content for the ABEL system is just as simple as developing content for pure data. It uses all the regular pure data vanilla objects and a small suite we developed to allow to tap into our specific system. So the process of developing content for this is as simple as creating a PD patch to be your main piece, hosting what you want the audience to be able to do in the form of a PD patch as well in a Dropbox folder, going to a website and generation configuration, you get a QR code, you distribute the QR code, and using your application, the audience scans the QR code, and the application sets up by itself. It auto-configurates all the needed files, it prepares all the needed modes and everything. So this system was already used in two concerts. In 2015, we did a concert in Porto in Casa da Música for 1,000 audience members. In this specific concert, we used communication over Wi-Fi. So one of the options we had would be to use web audio instead of pure data and dedicated Wi-Fi and everything. But web audio has a caveat. You have to be connected to internet, and apart from the let's call it the weight on a server you have from having 1,000 people connected at the same time and downloading things, you will have to compete with all the concurrent apps that people have on their smartphones, because once you are connected to the internet you have to deal with Facebook, you have to deal with Instagram and everything. And all of those are going to eat up bandwidth. And it gets a lot of a lot difficult to guarantee that you are able to deliver the message you have to deliver in order to make the all the smartphones synchronized. So this is a picture we did, the second concert we did this year in March in Berklee College of Music. And one of the things we had to choose is, and it's actually one of the features that gets most of the times people ask for, is that we only have one direction of communication. We didn't implement bi-directional. So we chose not to to implement bi-directional communication. For one, because it makes the task of building and managing the network infrastructure and all the equipment and everything a lot harder. And two, we wanted the smartphone to be, in this context, a self-contained and self-sufficient instrument. So you're actually playing something that generates, what it generates is for you and for everyone in your radius. And what we noticed with that is that on top of all the participative aspect, there was a collaborative aspect that arose. At one time, people were no longer focused on their own smartphones. They were starting to focus on their neighbors' smartphones, and they were swapping smartphones and trying everyone out. Another option we had had to do with the interface. So the interface, you can see it, is completely clean. You don't have any controls or anything. And that was a choice to try and not shift too much of the focus from the performance onto the device. It proved to not be enough because the novelty effect focuses, brings almost all the focus back on the smartphone. So what happened is that people started just looking at the smartphones or the smartphone next to them and less to what was going on stage. So that's actually one of the questions we have to address in the future, is this change of paradigm in developing music or developing performance, where you're no longer doing something for one or two or 10 people on stage, you're doing something for one or two or 10 people on stage and 1,000 or 3,000 in the audience. And you have to think of the composition and the creation process in a totally different way. So we wanted to make this system available to anyone. We're currently, let's call it an open beta stage. The website with all the configuration generation tools is available. The iOS app is already available on the App Store, and all functionalities for the iOS are working. I'm actually going to be presenting a small demo and poster tomorrow, so you're welcome to stop by and try it out and see if how it works. If you just want to download the app, it has just a small demo, it doesn't do much, but if you want to check it out, just scan this QR code, and I guess that's it. Thank you for listening.
Hello, I'm Jimena Alarcón, and today I want to share my ideas about tuning the interface for relational listening. This is basically coming out of my experience as a migrant, an exploration of what I have called the in-between space, and not only myself, but many artists have talked about the in-between space. Which Mariana Ortega talks about, that is a kind of a space created by people in exile when they are trying to negotiate the different spaces, the internal and the external environment. So I've been listening to my individual and also to collective migrations through my research and my artwork. So this human migration of experience is coming from the conceptual interfaces Jan was talking before. I think it's a collapse of cultural interfaces. You come to a different geography and then you have to really find ways to communicate. And that is what happened to me in my first migration. And it was basically linked to the big interface, which is public transport systems. This interface that we deal with everyday life. So it was a really big experience to come from a very unstructured environment in Bogota to a metro in Barcelona for the first time. So my relationship I started to interface with that culture through the metro, and at the same time I was learning digital technologies, CD-ROM, that was about 20 years ago. I'll leave the videos for you to explore it in your own time. Then I moved with the time to one of my other migrations to the UK, and I found the underground transport system again, but the first one in the world. And I started to focus on listening experiences of commuters there, not only my individual experience with the infrastructure, but a collective experience. The work evolved, and then I also had the chance to have the comparison with Paris Metro and with Mexico Metro, and I created an interactive virtual environment online where you have a virtual metro where you can travel through the three spaces, and you can find relationships between the three spaces and could touch you what is that urban culture, oral urban culture of about two centuries. I evolved my work into performance, network performance. So how we make relationships between the spaces, but also when we are sharing with people the listening of those spaces. So I create a collocated real-time improvisation for commuters, where they interact with their voices. Basically, they share their memories in the time when they are listening to that. So relationships between archives of place and others. Then I continue with my listening in between, and I focus on the experience of migration. So that is a bit more complex listening. And this listening in between distant locations, I work with the concept and the practice of deep listening, Paulino Oliveros deep listening, which is embodied listening. So we listen with the full body, not only with our ears. We listen 24 hours a day, we listen with dreams, we listen with the full body. And thanks to that listening, we experience an expansion of space and sound in space and time. And also networked listening, which I'm very keen on the development by Franziska Schroeder of this term, which she talks about when we are in networked listening, we have to unself to reach the other person who is in the other place. So we, in this unselfing, we reach a kind of in-between state. So I carry on with the telematic sonic performances that I've been conducting for the last 4 years. This is one of them, Migratory Dreams, between migrants living in London, Colombian migrants, and people in Bogota with experiences of migration. So that was about dreams. They were bringing their dreams in to the consciousness and sharing it and weaving them. So this is the video that I'm going to play for this presentation, just to you have a sense of it.
Abbastanza ospedale, buscano il sentito di pertenenza. Mi interessa il cuerpo come territorio di trasformazione. Paso sobre madera. Madera che cruje e se mueve al son del agua.
Sus palabras cargan sus emociones a la misma vez. Mis emociones se desarrollan junto a las personas que me rodean. el ser misterioso.
Soy como un pequeño cascabelito.
El cemento hacia lo natural.
Okay, so with all these experiences that I had, I started to talk to my colleagues, and together with Kathy Lane, we started to think of these experiences not only about my migration, but I'm tapping into something that is a shared context, which is about the making sense of place and making sense of memory and history that is common for all of us, and is increasing because we're having a contemporary sense of dislocation, rapid mobility, accumulation of data on the internet, of all our files, whatever we record. So we focus on the experience of listening to sound archives, specifically field recordings and speech. And we created this project and a startup project, which is a Sound Matters Framework, which is conceptual and technical. And we focus on two processes, the processes of interrogation and the process of relational playback. And I interview about 20 colleagues from an artist working with these materials and ask them how do they feel themselves, how do they see their work in their framework. So basically we focused that the most interesting part really for people was the relational playback, the creative, more creative part, because it's an opportunity to jam the archives, to undo traditional processes of the interrogation of data. Is a key process for ethnography, and also is the moment where aesthetics can be developed and sensibilities, that is something that the computer cannot make. So we brought together all these colleagues in a co-design workshop, and we asked them to imagine scenarios of, okay, you enter in a place full of sounds, and what do you do with these sounds? What do you want to do? So they say, well, we want to go, and we don't want to categorize. We just want to say this frequency, and then whatever it arrives, we start to make relations. We also can change the metadata in each project, the same material, but with different metadata. And we want to work with physical interfaces. So I was thinking, okay, this is going to an idea of to have something modular in practical terms, and I came across the Jamoma framework, Jamoma platform, which is something that I'm working in collaboration with Beck in Bergen, in Norway, to start to think really in a practical terms, how do we bring all these archives that are online and how we start to play with that. So from relational playback, we started to think further, and we thought that we are talking is about relational listening, and I'm finding out what it is, and this was the purpose of the paper. So Lawrence English has defined relational listening as an ability positioned in between the internal psychological and external technological listening. And with this definition, I bring my deep listening experience and the network listening, and I have this sonic in-betweenness that is what I'm interested in. So eventually, what I think is interfaces for relational listening, what is that? Is something that is within the context of contemporary rapid mobility, is something that can help to explore real-time interconnections between sound and people in shared and networked sonic spaces. They can become key tools and key concepts for tuning in our contemporary sense of place. They could challenge fixed cultural boundaries, as it has happened in telematic performances, and they can offer spaces for being and for social transformation. And it's 10 minutes. Thank you very much.
Well done for keeping it short.
So, you see something? So, where are we? Where are we?
So I work with ways of thinking about and working with audiences as a fundamental material to interaction design, a rather dynamic and unstable material. In some instances, very large audiences. Prior to this particular case study, I worked with audiences up to 200,000, at which point you really are talking about quite a dynamic material. This study is more about Punch Drunk in their work of theatre as a way to produce experience. The case study in question is The Drowned Man, in which an entire world called Temple Studios were built in Paddington, London, in a very large space. So this just gives an idea of the kind of the sheer volume and mass of their interface, as it were, and the sheer volume of people populating and animating this interface every night, sometimes twice. On Fridays and Saturdays, there are around 2 shows per night. So it's a very robust kind of interface that... So I'm going to whiz through some of the slides because I've got a little bit too much material. There's a huge amount of actual physicality and physical bodies involved in running this sort of interface. Nevertheless, it's run very much as a system with a set formula, which is perhaps best expressed through the spreadsheet that sits as this little secret ingredient backstage. This is 4 meters long. It's actually the secret to all that sort of exciting, dark, and disorientating stuff that goes on out front that people participate in. It's a spreadsheet. So I approach this kind of interaction design as interactive meaning-making from both sides of the interface. I worked with the company as a researching designer over 2 years, looking at the making culture of the company. I also looked into live and online audiences, very much thinking about audiences as included in the weird materialities of interaction design. The audience research occurred through semi-structured interviews, very loosely structured, because I actually want the texture of experience to come through quite long. Live audiences were popular. They were very in favour of the experience. I tried to find some that didn't like it, but I failed. The age range you got there, I also worked with 2 cohorts of online audiences, a very large one from TripAdvisor and also some from social media. What we're focusing on today is really the live audiences I worked with in more extensive interviews. So I analysed the interviews using a sort of dissertation framework, looking at tendencies of spatial operations, how we work with space as an extensive, dynamic space, or as an ordered and mapped place, which is more structured. Changing tactics was something that came out very strong in support of the idea that audiences are really quite unstable. And narrative regulation very much being a strong feature of how the company works with audiences. So unstable actors. An interactive system is not particularly... doesn't come alive until the audiences enter the space and start working with it. But that comes across very clearly in the interviews. However, none of these tendencies were really dominant in the audience members. And the closest to any kind of coordination was the sense of this collaborative work with spatial operations that I call narrative regulation. Because when you have 600 people running around in the dark in a very disorientating environment, you do need to manage them somehow. And in the case of Punch Drunk, that occurs through narrative, embedded into the sets, embedded into the acting and the performance, and the interaction with audiences at every stage. This comes through very nice and clear when you work with the company interviews. They are obviously very aware of the need to, the audience is there to have a good time. You can't police them, yeah? So you need to work with them in a way that enhances the experience. So the narrative regulation, spatial operation tendency or approach to the work is clearly dominated in the company interviews, with the extension of space and experience potential coming in as a clear second, and with the order actually coming in, the sense of mapping and ordering and controlling coming in last. Audiences broadly speaking, take an exploratory approach to the experience. They all, both those who like and dislike the environment, describe it in terms emphasizing the disorientation of it, the darkness, the mystery, the challenges, the difficulty of actually finding out what's happening. In response to that, they produce actions that very focused on cognitive processes, but also embodied exploration. And the third large overarching category were actions that describe the synthesis and process of these kind of inputs. So interaction design, again returning a little bit to that, as a conclusion, it is incomplete without the audience actually animating the system. In contrast then to more traditional software engineering, where you think of user modeling in more static terms, I started asking a lot of questions in relation to how PunchDrunk work with audiences. The term user really doesn't ring right, so I kept thinking about participant as a better term, and how to model participant, how to conceptualize participation, how to think about it, and how to imagine it in the making. It becomes quite clear then that agency is actually more important than agent. We don't necessarily need to model the participant because they are unstable. They don't stay the same. They change in response to the environment, and they are dynamic, and that is a very key part of the attraction to the experience itself. So moving towards agency rather than modeling the agent itself. So just a little rundown on more generic traditional user modeling in software engineering is very much focused on more reductive principles, what happened in the past, in what way does the participant, the imagined participant, respond or correspond with stereotypes, narrowed down behaviors. Immediately the question arises whether that is actually compatible with the idea of a dynamic audience and an unstable audience that changes. Obviously it kind of doesn't. So the question there, in how do you work with an unstable audience? I've used the post-human discourse to look at the propensity for metamorphosis. That seems to be one of the main attractions. People love the potential for change, the being unsettled, being disrupted. They actually embrace that and enjoy it in this particular instance, which is obviously a system that is closed. People know sort of what they're getting into, and they are a paying audience, so you know it's not an open citywide experience. However, some of the events that I worked with in the past were, we're talking about 200,000 people running amok, as it were, to performance and rhythm and things happening in the city. One framework that comes out for me quite strongly when you think about how and why people actually enjoy and seek out this disorientation is the framework of the sublime, the postmodern sublime, especially in the hands of Lyotard, where we look at experiences and also come through quite clear in people's description, awe, a vertigo, a sense of disorientation, a sense of not knowing who you are anymore. And in addition, also people in these performances are masked, they don't speak, they're separated from their friends, their quotidian reality and identity is deprioritized and actually shifted for the duration of the performance. So performances last about 3 hours. And during that time, you have enough time to actually become quite disoriented. So that sense of dissolution, the potential dissolution of your quotidian identity is key to the experience somehow. And this fits in rather nicely with the framework of the sublime, which is a different kind of beauty, as it were. Not the known, the stable, the ordered beauty. So Lyotard's sublime talks about the secondary privation of threat. The threat in this case not necessarily being the chasm that you see in the romantic paintings of the romantic sublime. It's more the sense of loss of self, loss of reason, confusion, essentially. And moving this through to digital systems, perhaps interaction design, how do you find proxies for that? So we could look at emergent behaviors in interactive systems, and how we could find ways of expressing or triggering the sense of threat twice removed in relation to the possibility of dissolution of self. So to find material for this kind of analysis in Punchdrunk's work, they kind of devise for the sublime. We look at scale, disorientation, excess experience capacity, which extends the potential, the sense of an expansive space that you might not actually be able to fully survey. I mentioned the deprioritization of the quotidian identity before, and very importantly, the potential for transgression. You may do something bad. Somebody may do something bad or unpredictable to you, and you don't know. You know you're in an ordered scenario, so you know the likelihood that it's not going to be terminal is quite strong. We're looking at a system that has agencies hidden in the shadows, and I'll return to that in a moment, the black masks. Things that you didn't know were live, as it were, had a potential for interacting with you. And there's a sense of kind of vertigo in that experience that comes through nicely in the interviews. So this sort of devising this opportunity for vertigo is part of their work. Articulating the shadows, the black masks, so very quickly, I don't think we need to go through that. That's sort of more comments from the company describing how they think about audiences as a material. When you work with a live audience, they get up to stuff. People try to have sex on set, they steal things, occasions where performers have been molested, endangering themselves, audiences, you know, sometimes drunk. There's all sorts of things that might happen. In response to that, the black masks, who are invisible, they play a hidden role within the set, are important for articulating and meeting those behaviours within the set as a kind of live part of the set, an agentic part of the set. Very interesting function that would function quite well within a digital scenario. And the benefit of this kind of narrative regulation of audience behaviours is that they extend the experiential space and actually enhance the experience of audiences. Many interviewees talk about how they actually enjoy feeling that their agency somehow shifted. They don't know where they stop and the other begins. So that's something that I would position as a way for taking forward development and interaction design, particularly in software engineering, what's underneath the hood, how we might be able to facilitate this kind of in-system agency. So part of that is, of course, where we draw externalities. So we might not like to think about the shadow side when we think about interaction design, but audiences get up to trouble. So rethinking externalities, incorporating these behaviours, and perhaps even harnessing potential deviation to enhance interaction design would be my proposal for interaction design as we go forward. And if we look at society as a whole, as an interaction design, if we started meeting and incorporating the shadow side in how we think about audiences, maybe we would avoid it, the utter mess the UK now finds itself in. Thank you.
Right, you've got a question.
I've got a question for Mike. Mike, I was wondering when you were looking at the shape of the quads and the sound that goes with it and the inherent type of sound that goes with a round object, whether you considered changing the shape of the object to something like a cube or something with spikes and then changing the sound. Have you considered all of those?
I have thought about it, because obviously with inflatables it's something that's very possible to do, but we haven't tried that out yet. What I did do as part of my PhD research actually was to try smaller versions of different shapes, kind of basic shapes like cones and spheres and squares, you know, cubes and things like that, and try those with different sounds. So on a small scale I've done some kind of subjective empirical looking at that, but we haven't done anything with a big public art installation size. It would be fun to do, actually. We'd like to do it. Well, we've actually been, I didn't have a chance to talk about it in the talk, but Alison and I, so I do the piece with Alison Ballard, the artist, we have a kind of test, which is that we try out new sounds, and if when we approach the pod, if it sounds like a speaker inside an inflatable, that sound is ditched. So there are some sounds that do seem to somehow bind to the object, and most of those are long and flowing, but there are some kind of more talkative or conversational sounds that work as well. But is that if they feel like they're part of a unified object, then they're in, and otherwise they get ditched. So, yeah.
Okay. More questions? Sally Jane.
Yeah, for Ximena, I'm intrigued. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about the unself to reach the other. I realize that you're taking us from Francesca's Trudeau, but it seems to me that one could also take legitimately the opposite standpoint and say that in order to reach the other, one must posit oneself more strongly. I feel as though there's something kind of warm and fuzzy and slightly worrying about unselfing.
Yeah, I think it's a state. I mean, it's not a definite thing that you unself and that's it. But in the process of, well, what Franziska Schroeder talks, actually, she talks the experience of the buteau dancers. This is where she brings this idea of in between a state and this unselfing, and she talks at in network performances. Her experience is with musicians. In order to really play with the others, you need to go out of your own playing only for yourself and thinking only about what you are playing. That is probably what happens with improvisation, when you need to listen to yourself and to the others. But when it's networked, when it's in the distance, because also we have the layer of the delay, these things are a bit stronger. So that happens in what I like, I'm keen on that, because that reflects experiences that participants in my performance have had in a moment where they say, well, this is my story, let's say this is my dream, but at the same time it's no longer only my dream. So it departs from an individual experiences, but it belongs something that is shared, and I'm kind of there. And I like this also idea, probably one paper, I don't remember, but it was giving me these hints of the body, of the phantom body. So sometimes in my imagination is that. And I have actually written a paper about embodiments. So it's like you disembody you. That is what happens in migration too, no? Sometimes the body is here but not really here. You experience lots of changes. So I found the unselfing not as a fixed state, but it's a state that happens and that is interesting. Socially and individually. Mm-hmm.
You're welcome.
Do we have any more questions?
My question would be to face-to-face performers.
Yeah.
Algorithms. So, just recently, a Wired journal published an article with the name that at the end of quote. So there will be no algorithms. It's connected with machine learning, that the performer, or maybe a coder, programmer, non-programmers, they actually couldn't understand how grand is constructed. And so how you maybe think in this future, nearby future, that there will be no algorithms anymore and no programmers.
So I think this relates to the whole robot rising and kind of being overruled by artificial intelligence discourse. And there was a really interesting article I read recently, I think it was an anthropologist, who was remarking on the fact that the natural intelligence has a structure that comes from evolution, comes from our embeddedness, is 2 billion years old, and is really the result of incredibly complex chain of developments. So for the computer to reach the same level, that would also take a lot of time, even if it's faster. That's one thing. And the other thing is that, and that was the argument in the article, that we're not capable of imagining the unknown algorithm. I think we've had, today we've had this knowing, known, unknown, no. And that goes in a similar direction. We're not capable of designing a system that can completely transgress its bounds. So the argument there was that there's not going to be any artificial intelligence that actually evolves into something non-human. Okay, that being said, and I'm not sure whether I can completely subscribe to that, but what I think is that algorithm is not necessarily code. Algorithm is a rule system, and we're obeying rules right now. I mean, social interaction is an algorithm, is a rule-based system. And I think arts is about human interrelations, so they're always guided by rules. So in that sense, even if technology changes and code changes its status or disappears in some way, I think we'll still be faced with agency of objects, of tools. Language as a tool, for example, has an agency, etc. So I think it's much more complex than just saying code disappears. It might change. Who knows? Okay?
Is this a question for one of the people who haven't spoken yet? Do you have a question?
Just more of a reaction, but
to continue,
really
okay,
I can throw it in the room. So I think about what I sort of hear from you, but several sort of supports my rather provocative thesis that there's only human-human interaction.
I mean, ultimately, yes, because the perceiver will be human again in a cultural domain, not in a technical domain, but in a cultural domain.
I guess the question for any stroke or panel members, actually, because it's a sort of meta question. A really well structured session, because there was a narrative arc to it. We started off with the isolated brain, and we ended up with a kind of meta organism of an audience and cast. And consequently, lots of different disciplines feeding into each of the things, and then consequently, lots of different methodologies and ontologies at work. So, I guess my question, he says, finally, how are we going to talk to each other about these things, coming from all these disparate disciplines? I think we're still talking at and sometimes past each other. So, given the diversity of the panel, what are the thoughts for actual kind of post-disciplinary discourse for interface design?
Yeah, so words
of advice for how to talk to people. So the case study in question that I worked with is extremely interdisciplinary. You have technicians, you have programmers, you have makers of every shape, size and description, basically. And the narrative is actually what holds them together. Each person, each department works within that real living, breathing case study to the fullest point of their expertise, but within a narrative. So the narrative regulation of the audience is actually something that is equally important on the maker side. And the longer I work with this project, the more I see that it's actually kind of the same process that connects both sides. So to me, it makes very little sense to have a really clear break between the participant and maker on that side, the audience, and the meaning maker on this side of the interface. So, you know, the narrative, which is why we're here, really, to talk about the narratives of interaction. So that would be my 5 cents.
Francesco and Alex, do you like to add a last word to that?
Well, I subscribe, actually, what she said. I don't feel, if I understood right the question, I don't feel there must be different roles, things separated. I don't feel it at all. I don't know. It's not a question that I ever discussed to be honest. I don't feel any real difference between me programming something, me designing something, and combining things, as long as we're working with other people. So I guess that's my thoughts.
Non-disciplinary.
I don't know how I can really add up to anything that already has been said, but from my experience, I feel we're going further away from that distinction, that role distinction, and from all the people I've worked with, interface designers, musicians, coders, everything, the feeling I get is that the roles are increasingly overlapping. So it's getting increasingly easier to talk to each other, because that overlapping allows us to better understand what others are doing. So to me, the tendency will be to have always a core role, but to be a lot more encompassing than up till now.
Great, that's, yeah, I'll drink to that. Probably just coffee, but unless... Okay, so we have to make a hole in the wall. And then we're back in this room, I think, in 25 minutes. Is that right?
Yeah.